Well, good morning, Barton Church. Great to see everybody here this morning. If you're connecting with us online, we're grateful you can connect with us as well. He is risen. Amen. We are so excited you are here to worship with us this morning. A few announcements or reminders as we begin our time of worship together this morning. This week, men's and women's Bible studies happen on Tuesday. Men's at 9:30. And women's at 10? All right, yeah. Tuesdays, you're welcome to come and be a part of that. Men are meeting in the gym here and the ladies in the fellowship hall. That's Tuesdays for men's and women's Bible studies. Our preschool is already registering for students next year, and we still have a few openings left, one opening in the a.m. and about 7 in the p.m. And so if you know a preschool family or a family that has preschool-age children, we want to let you know about Barton Church Preschool. And so you can go to our website, bartonchurch.org/preschool, and check out more about that. And sign up there if you're interested. But those openings are already happening for next year. And then I also want to just remind you or make you aware of a great problem we have. And that problem is we have so many little kids in the nursery and even at children's church that we need more helpers. We need people to help serve these young families through the nursery ministry and then also children's church ministry. And so if you'd be interested in that, please contact me. We will train you. We won't let you on your own and make you do everything yourself. We will train you and help you in that way. But we need some more helpers for both the nursery ministry and the children's church ministry. Speaking of those, if you do have young ones, nursery is available right now down the hallway to the left for newborn up through 3, and then children's church will happen a little later on in the service. I'll let you know when the kids can go to children's church, and that's for 4 years old up through 5th grade. I think that's it for announcements. I'd encourage you to read your bulletin at another time, see what else is going on in the life of the church. But we want to begin our time of worship together. Would you stand with me? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we could come together and we could come worship you in a variety of ways. Lord, singing songs, giving of our tithes and offerings, encouraging one another, reading your word, listening to it, studying it, and prayer. Father, may you be honored and glorified as we remember the resurrection and, Lord, just how important that is for each one of us now. We lift high your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We'll be right back.
have a space in between you, it'd be really helpful if we could move to the middle. And so there's some open spots on the outer edges as people continue to come in. That's a great problem to have.
Promise your very body.
1, 3 through 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice. Amen.
Praise his name forevermore. Better put my eyes on here first. Okay, Proverbs 13. A wise son accepts his father's discipline, but a scoffer does not listen to rebuke. From the fruit of a man's mouth, he enjoys good, but the desire of the treacherous is violence. The one who guards his mouth preserves his life. The one who opens wide his lips comes to ruin. The soul of a sluggard craves and gets nothing, but the soul of the diligent is made fat. A righteous man hates falsehood, but a wicked man acts disgustingly and shamefully. Righteousness guards those whose way is blameless, but wickedness subverts the sinner. There is one who pretends to be rich but has nothing, and another who pretends to be poor and has great wealth. The ransom of a man's life is his wealth, but the poor hears no rebuke. The light of the righteous rejoices, but the lamp of the wicked goes out. Through insolence comes nothing but strife, but wisdom is with those who receive counsel. Wealth obtained by fraud dwindles, but the one who gathers by labor increases it. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but desire fulfilled is a tree of life. The one who despises the word will be in debt to it, but the one who fears the commandment will be rewarded. The teaching of the wise is a fountain of life, to turn aside from the snares of death. Good understanding produces favor, but the way of the treacherous is hard. Every prudent man acts with knowledge, but a fool displays folly. A wicked messenger falls into adversity, but a faithful envoy brings healing. Poverty and shame will come to him who neglects discipline, but he who regards reproof will be honored. Desire realized is sweet to the soul, but it is an abomination to fools. Turn away from evil. He who walks with wise men will be wise, but the companion of fools will suffer harm. Adversity pursues sinners, but the righteous will be rewarded with prosperity. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. Abundant food is in the fallow ground of the poor, but it is swept away by injustice. He who withholds his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him diligently. The righteous has enough to satisfy his appetite, but the stomach of the wicked is in need.
Join with me in prayer, would you? Heavenly Father, thank you for the wisdom of Proverbs 13. Lord, in that contrast between the wicked and the righteous, help us, Lord, to live lives that are righteous, right living according to your word, Lord, that would honor and bring glory to you. Lord, help us not to live for ourselves or look to puff someone else up or be selfish in that way, but Lord, help us to serve you and serve others. Lord, bring opportunities in our lives to do that, to love you and to love others. Help us to answer that call without hesitation, without nervousness, but to meet the needs of others around. Lord, there are many needs in our church family. We pray for those, Lord, who are ill and unable to be here today. Lord, would you minister to them? Would you help heal their bodies? We think of Phil Petriquin specifically, Lord, as he is in the hospital and trying to see if this medicine works on his heart valve. Lord, we lift him up to you and pray that you would do a mighty work in his life, in his body. We pray for others who have recently had surgeries or are going to this week, Lord, that you would give them peace that passes all understanding. Lord, help us to know how to meet needs, whether we send a note of encouragement or we give them a call or stop by with a meal. Lord, use us to show love to others. Thank you, Father, for your Son. And Lord, as we celebrate the resurrection this morning, Lord, that all-powerful event, Lord, you give us the same power through your Holy Spirit to live lives that would honor you. So, Lord, may we trust in you each and every day. Lord, may we consider not only our actions, but our words and our thoughts, that those would honor you as well. Thank you, Lord, for the power of the cross and the resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we're going to let children go to the middle there for children's church. I'm going to encourage you to turn around, say hi to someone you haven't said hi to yet, and then we'll bring you back with God's word. All right, if you want to make your way back to your seat, please. All right. Lots of new faces. It is great to see everybody here this morning. If this is your first time to Barton Church, welcome. My name is Ben. I serve as the pastor here, and we are just really excited that you've chose to join us in worship this morning. We're going to be in John chapter 19, or at least I should say we're going to start in John chapter 19 this morning, and then we're going to fly all around God's word. Just really grateful for everybody here this morning. God, you know our hearts, and you know how powerful your word is, and so we ask, Lord, humbly to let your word go forth from the Bible, through the Holy Spirit, through me. Lord, use me however you want, and Lord, may we set aside any distractions that might be in place just to focus in on you and the power of your death and resurrection right now. In Jesus' name, amen. So last week, we began investigating one of Jesus' last words on the cross. It is finished. From John 19:30, and it says, therefore, when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished, and he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. It is finished in the original Greek is just one word, tetelestai. And it was used by ordinary, average people in everyday life. The word means it is finished, or it's complete, or done, the end. And as we saw last week, for Jesus, Tetelestai was much more than just the end of his earthly life. Tetelestai was this wide-ranging, comprehensive expression regarding himself, his enemies, the old covenant, his heavenly Father, and even you and me. It is finished. Let's do a quick recap of last week's main points, and you can listen to or watch an in-depth study of the sermon at our website or YouTube channel if you want to see that at another time. First, we saw that it is finished signals the end to his sufferings of body and soul. 2 days ago, we considered at our Good Friday service of darkness the toll of his sufferings in his body. Handcuffed, blindfolded, hit, slapped, mocked, spat on, crown of thorns pressed into his head. He was flogged and whipped, forced to carry a wooden cross, hands and feet nailed to it, then suspended upright so that his body struggled to breathe for 6 hours. And then there was the toll of his sufferings of his soul as well. Weeping for Jerusalem as he's paraded in, concerned for the disciples, Judas's betrayal, Peter's denials, John's responsibility for his mother, the internal anguish of what was about to take place. Last Sunday, Palm Sunday, began a week-long intense suffering of body and soul for Jesus. It is finished, ended, all that pain and agony. Next we saw, it is finished is the end to all persecution from his enemies. For the entirety of Jesus's 3 to 3.5 years of ministry, he was persecuted. Satan, demons, the religious leaders, and Roman leaders. Jesus's persecutors had done their worst by crucifying him to death, but with it is finished, they are forever out of his reach. It is finished is the end to all persecution from his enemies. A third implication for it is finished, the end to his life on earth. Jesus was born a real baby who grew up into a real man and really died. Every year we celebrate his birth at Christmas. It is finished marked his last breath. Jesus physically died on that cross. From that same verse, it is finished, and he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Jesus' heart stopped beating. His blood stopped pumping. His lungs stopped breathing. His brain stopped functioning. He really died. And then we considered a fourth repercussion of it is finished, the fulfillment of the Old Testament law. Jesus announced in Matthew 5:17, "Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I came to fulfill it." It is finished fulfills the holy standard of the law perfectly upheld by Jesus. The strict requirements obeyed and the ceremonial observances finally and fully satisfied. Here is how one Bible commentator explains Jesus' fulfillment of the law. In living a perfect life, Jesus fulfilled the moral laws. In his sacrificial death, Jesus filled the ceremonial laws. Christ came not to destroy the old religious system, but to build upon it. He came to finish the old covenant and establish the new. Tetelestai, it is finished. The shadows of a better covenant are done away with Jesus' fulfillment of the law. That's just a quick recap of last week. Let's consider three more implications of it is finished. All right, number 5. It is finished completes all the prophecies and types of the Old Testament concerning him. The Old Testament is filled with prophecies and types of Jesus, the Messiah. from the specifics of his death, like Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5, says, "Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed." And then there's the prophecies of his birth, Micah 5:2. "But as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity." And there's prophecies even how Jesus would teach. Psalm 78, 1 through 2. "Listen, O my people, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old." The manner of which he would enter into Jerusalem was even prophesied. Zechariah 9:9. "Rejoice, O greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey." These are just a few samples of the prophecies made concerning Jesus in the Old Testament. There are many others. How he suffered, his being betrayed for 30 pieces of silver, his hands and feet being pierced, his garments being divided, and so much more was predicted hundreds of years before. Bible scholars believe there are 300 prophecies regarding Jesus in the Old Testament. "It is finished" completes every prophecy. And then there are the types. And what I mean by types are people, places, objects, or events which foreshadow Jesus and his work in the Old Testament. One example is explained by Bible commentator Gregory Brown. In Genesis 14, we learn of a man named Melchizedek. Maybe you know the story. Abraham honored Melchizedek by paying tithes to him. And one of the things that makes Melchizedek unique is that he was a king and a priest. In Israel, those roles were kept distinct. The king was not a priest, and the priest was not a king. Kings were supposed to come from the line of David, and priests were to come from the Levitical line through Aaron's children. In the New Testament, though, we read in Hebrews chapter 7, the author makes the argument that the new covenant is greater than the old covenant because it has a greater priesthood. God promised that Jesus would be a priest like Melchizedek instead of a Levite priest. The priesthood of Melchizedek is greater than the Levite priesthood because Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, which shows how great he was. And since there's no record of Melchizedek's death, technically he remains a priest. And because of this, Melchizedek is a type of Jesus, a priest and king with an eternal priesthood. Another type of Jesus is Noah's Ark. In the same way that God saved Noah's family who entered the ark from the judgment of the flood, God now saves all who are in Christ. Outside of Christ, will experience God's eternal wrath. Listen to 1 Peter 3, 20 and 21. It says, "Who once were disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah during the construction of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons were brought safely through the water. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you, not the removal of dirt from the flesh," so not the baptism that we do as an ordinance, "but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven after the angels and authorities and powers have been subjected to him." And so the Noah's Ark even is a type of Christ or a type of Jesus. Those who put their faith in him are baptized into him, including his death and resurrection, and they'll be saved from God's future wrath. There are many more types. Adam, the first man, Moses, Isaac, Joseph, David, Jacob's ladder, the bronze serpent, manna, tabernacle, cities of refuge, and of course, the Passover lamb, to just name a few. The Old Testament is full of types and prophecies of Jesus. Remember last week how I said that the Greek word tetelestai was used in everyday language? How when a priest examined the animal sacrifice and found it spotless, he would say, tetelestai, complete? Well, in Jesus' day, when an artist completed a picture or a writer completed a manuscript, he or she might say, tetelestai, it is finished. Warren Wiersbe concludes, the death of Jesus on the cross completes the picture that God had been painting, the story that he had been writing for centuries. And so, it is finished, completes all the prophecies and types of the Old Testament concerning him. The picture of Jesus is complete. Here's a sixth implication of it is finished. It is finished signaled the finished obedience to the Father's plan. God the Father had a plan for his son Jesus to redeem the world. When was that plan made? When Jesus showed up on earth? When the first man, Adam, sinned? When was this plan by God made? In his first sermon, Peter, on the day of Pentecost, under the influence of the Holy Spirit, he declares this in Acts chapter 2, verses 22 and 23. He says, "Men of Israel, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs, which God performed through him in your midst, just as you yourselves know, this man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death." This man, delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. Before Jesus ever started ministering, before his birth, before the Old Testament covenant, before Moses, Abraham, even Adam, the first sinner, God the Father, in his infinite wisdom and foreknowledge, had a plan. Listen to 1 Peter 1, 18 through 21. "Knowing that you are not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood, as a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. For he was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but has appeared in these last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God." A different translation of verse 20 says, "He was chosen before the creation of the world." Before anything was even created, God knew the future and made a plan. Jesus was willing to obey God's plan for him, to be the lamb that he would offer himself so that you and I could go free. The cross and the tomb were not God's reactive solution to the problem of sin. It was his proactive solution to what he saw would happen. And Jesus was all in to complete or finish God's plan. In Jesus' day, a servant might say tetelestai when reporting to their master, "It is finished," or "The work that you assigned me is completed." When Jesus began his sufferings, you might remember in the garden, he says, "Father, your will be done." And now on the cross, he says, "It is finished." Tetelestai, the finished obedience to the Father's plan. And then finally, it is finished, man's redemption and salvation. We know God had a plan from the beginning of time to redeem us. But the sting of sin began in the garden with Adam and Eve. The first glimmer of the gospel in the Bible is found in the first book of Genesis. Genesis 3:15, when God curses Satan, the serpent, for tempting Eve, he declares, "I will put enmity," that another word for animosity, "between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head and you shall bruise him on the heel." God said there would be this perpetual struggle and enmity between satanic forces and all humanity. It would be between Satan and the woman and their respective offspring or seeds. The offspring of the woman was first Cain, and then all humanity at large, and then Jesus, and then those collectively in him. In light of the context of this verse, Jesus was bruised on the heel. Being crucified on the cross, nails were driven into his hands and his feet, his heels. Jesus, despite being perfect, sinless, gave himself up willingly to be beaten and arrested and technically tortured by being crucified on the cross. But it was a temporary defeat. Only his heel was bruised. Listen to these illustrative words from Charles Spurgeon. He says, "Look at your master and your king upon the cross, all distained with blood and dust. There was his heel most cruelly bruised. When they take down that precious body and wrap it in fair white linen and in spices and lay it in Joseph's tomb, they weep as they handle the casket in which the deity had dwelt. For there again, Satan had bruised his heel. The devil had let loose Herod and Pilate and Caiaphas and the Jews and the Romans. That is all, however. It is only his heel and not his head that is bruised. For lo, the champion rises again." Satan delivered a terrible blow to Jesus on Good Friday. No doubt he thought he had thrown a knockout punch. But he was wrong. All he did was strike Jesus on the heel. As painful as it was, the suffering was nothing compared to what Jesus did to Satan. When Jesus died on the cross, he delivered a crushing blow to Satan. Who do you think won that battle? The text says bruise, but the word can also be translated crush. Crushed heels are painful, but they don't kill us. No one survives a crushed head. The cross was God's death blow against Satan. And when Jesus died and rose from the dead, he utterly defeated Satan, sin, and death. Amen? Amen. Amen. Listen to Revelation 12, 9 through 11. "And a great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, 'Now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of the brethren has been thrown down, he who accuses them before our God day and night. And they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony. And they did not love their life even when faced with death.'" It is finished, man's redemption and salvation. An end made for sin and the beginning of everlasting righteousness. This applies to you and me. This is not a fairy tale. This is not for someone else. This is about you and me. Our sin has been defeated. Righteousness has been gifted to us through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are no longer dead, but alive in him. Archaeologists have recovered receipts for taxes from Jesus' day. Yes, even in Jesus' day, there were taxes. Archaeologists have recovered receipts from taxes in Jesus' day with the word tetelestai written across it, paid in full. The debt of sin, which we are told is the wages of sin or the wages of death, is paid in full by Jesus for us. How can we not be doing cartwheels right now? Right? Matthew Henry writes, "It is finished. That is, the work of man's redemption and salvation is now completed. At least the hardest part of the undertaking is over. A full satisfaction is made to the justice of God. A fatal blow given to the power of Satan. A fountain of grace open that shall ever flow. A foundation of peace and happiness laid that shall never fail. It is finished, man's redemption and salvation." The implication of Jesus' death and resurrection have eternal consequences for each and every person who has ever lived. This means you and me. The gospel of the good news of Jesus Christ is the reality that before time began, God had a plan to redeem man from his sin and death. Jesus, God's Son, obeyed his Father's plan and came to earth as a man, but not just a man, a mere man. He lived a perfect, sinless life, resisting temptations and enduring persecution from all sorts. And he humbly went to the cross, physically dying in our place, taking on our sin, tetelestai, paid in full. Jesus died, was buried, and then resurrected back to glorious life. Jesus is alive today. Amen. Do you believe that? Jesus is alive today. He has ascended into heaven. He's waiting beside God to return and forever establish his kingdom, just as God the Father promised, just as he planned. Jesus' actions pave a way then for you and I to have our sins forgiven and begin an eternal relationship with God the Father. And so I wonder, and I ask the question, the heart question to you this morning, have you made Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life? Have you put all your faith into him, surrendering your will for his? If you haven't, today is the day. Today is the day. Put all your faith and trust in Jesus. You will be forgiven. You will be adopted into God's family forever and begin a new life of freedom and true purpose. People are looking today for all sorts of purpose, and they put it into things, and they put it into careers, and they follow other people, and sometimes they put it into their spouses or their kids and others, and there's only one true purpose. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." It is an exclusive statement, and you have to wrap your brain around that. And either you will trust him and believe in him, or you will reject him and not believe in him. Make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life today. It's not hard to do. In fact, bow your heads with me, please. We're going to pray. If that's you today, if the Lord is speaking to you about the truth of who his Son is, Jesus, and you want to make a decision to follow him, I'm going to pray this prayer, and you can pray just right after me in your own heart. And if that's you today, you could pray something like this: "God, thank you for loving me. I confess that I've sinned against you. I believe that your Son Jesus died on a cross to pay for my sin and that you raised him from the dead. I trust Jesus alone to forgive me and take away all my sins. I confess that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Thank you for your gift of eternal life. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If that's you, if you made that prayer, if you said that in your heart, then you are a child of God and you've been adopted into his family, and we want to celebrate with you. Please come talk to me after service, and I will tell you more about what it means to be a Christian, which means little Christ, and to follow him each and every day. If we were to read the account of Jesus' death in the Gospel of John too quickly, we might think his phrase of "it is finished" was just about that moment in time. But it was infinitely so much more. It is finished. The end to his sufferings of body and soul. The end to all persecution from his enemies. The end to his life on earth. The end to all the prophecies and types of the Old Testament concerning him. The finished obedience to God the Father's plan. It is finished. Man's redemption and salvation. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the resurrection, the death and resurrection, and the implications it has to me and everyone listening. Lord, help us not to waste this time and just to poo-poo this off, but Lord, help us to take it seriously. Lord, help us to internalize this as truth. Lord, some are wavering, thinking it's a fairy tale, or maybe they don't want to give up their own will. Lord, I pray that you would show them the power of your word and that you really do have the best possible outlook for their life. Lord, show them the depths of your love, as we have seen here that your son was willing. He didn't have to, but he was willing to die, to be tortured for our sin. And while we were still sinners, he died for us. Help us to understand the depths of love you've shown us. Lord, some are disappointed and don't believe in you because they don't think you've done what you've said you would do. Lord, show them your eternal perspective of their life. Show them the bigger plan that you have for their life. And those circumstances that turned out horribly and that brought about confusion and hurt, Lord, show them that there's a bigger plan that brings honor to you and also brings peace and hope through the gospel. Speak to hearts today, Lord, we pray. Lives that would be changed, lives that would be made new because of Jesus' death and resurrection. And let it is finished mean the death of our sin and the start of a new life in you. Thank you today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing one more song together celebrating his resurrection?